Thank you very much, Haldor. And it's a great pleasure for me to be here and also a privilege. So thanks for giving me the opportunity to visit EMBL as well. I've had a campus tour and I'm most impressed with the facilities and the number of staff that are working here and the exchange programs. And I believe what I will talk about will be relevant to you as molecular biologists, potentially working with human biological samples, for instance, from abroad. Is the sound okay? Does everybody hear me? I would like to start with something else rather than explaining to you what ethics dumping means. It's something that here in this place will be cherished a lot, namely science and mobility, the mobility of young researchers. This is something you rely on. I heard that 80 countries are represented on this campus, and you will therefore obviously also agree with the statement here published in Nature that science has the most impact when scientists are free to move. A publication in Microbiology Letters, which is directly relevant to you, has also shown the major benefits of scientific mobility and international collaboration. The abstract is so good that I brought it for you. Science is international by nature. Yeah, you can read it yourself. Young scientists, we have many here, benefit greatly from exchanges, and scientific discovery, etc., will be promoted this way. That's what EMBL really stands for. I saw the major new house for training. Now, on the other side of this spectrum, and I've brought you here a quote from a Maori professor, Maori as in New Zealand. For her community, research is a dirty word. And she goes even further and says, researchers have told us things already known, suggested things that would not work and made careers for people who already had jobs. And these were not researchers from the community, but these were people who came from outside. And she called them inquisitive and acquisitive strangers. So I want to show you a video at the start from the Sun community in the Kalahari, which is Botswana, Namibia, and South Africa, who have been exploited in terms of human biological samples and also their traditional knowledge. And here is one person in a 1 minute clip who gives his view on this. And your colleague from IT has prepared this beautifully for me. So let's see.
Skolletjies het baie van hulle diep deurdrongende inheemse kennisse van gebruik gemaak om baie medisyne aan tafel te lê tot oorlewing van mense. Verskillende plaae het ingewelm en ons moet kennis by mekaar gooi om al daardie siektes te dood. Terwijl mijn grootvoorvaders en haar moeder gesterf het. Terwijl hulle zulke groot kennisse vir die aarde neergeleid, moet het maar eeuwig so gaan.
So this is the other side of the coin, how people feel exploited by researchers. And one of the reasons for this talk is to show how this could be reduced or ameliorated in the future. So on the one side, we have the mistrust of researchers, and they are even called acquisitive strangers. You will probably also know the term helicopter research, where people from high-income countries fly into low-income settings, take samples, or do research during an epidemic, fly out, and the benefits of the research don't return. For instance, at the moment, there is a big debate about researchers in the Congo going from London into a war zone in the Congo in order to do Ebola research during an epidemic. So the ethical issues around this are also issues around helicopter research. And then on the other side, I don't need to explain this to you, you personify this, the mobility of scientists is extremely important and leads to prosperity. Okay, now if in the 21st century you now add what was meant to be long gone, namely violations of research ethics, you can see why the mistrust can develop. A term that was coined by somebody in the European Commission, namely ethics dumping, has really taken off now, and this is also the title of the lecture, and I'd like to explain to you with cases what ethics dumping means. It's essentially the offshoring or the export of research that would not be allowed in a high-income country to a setting where either the compliance mechanisms are not strong enough or there aren't even legal requirements. And usually this is a lower income country or a lower middle income country. There are four reasons for ethics dumping, four main reasons. The first one is that, and I'll give you examples for all. The first one is that communities are unable to defend themselves. There may be sufficient laws, but they do not have access to lawyers, for instance, or they may not be aware of the rights they have. The second one is that researchers from high income settings, could be any of you, go into a lower income setting unaware of what they would need to do in order to do their research ethically. The third one is exploiting a loophole in the lower or middle income country and going on purpose into a research setting where this loophole can be exploited. And the last one is that research ethics committees who are meant to be the barrier for the protection, they are so under-resourced in some LMICs that they're not able to protect, especially human participants. But it can also be the environment or animals. Okay, I'd first like to give you two examples. One is a video again, for people unable to stand up for their own rights. This is a trial, a clinical trial in India. It enrolled 370,000 Indian women, and 141,000 were put into a no treatment control arm on cervical cancer for cervical cancer prevention. And in India, since the 1970s, they have cytology screening as the measure against cervical cancer, but these women were not given any, which would not have been allowed in the country of the funder, which was the US. And as a result, 245 of them died from cervical cancer. So this was a study that was funded by the US, would not have been allowed in the US, and took place in India. And as a result, there were avoidable deaths. So this is a clear example of double standards in research and what one would call ethics dumping. Yep. That's another case study. India has a lot of infrastructure for medical research and is therefore a very popular destination for people from high income countries. So this was not a public funder, it was a corporation, pharmaceutical company. They recruited CROs, contract research organizations, to undertake the research they wanted undertaken. And one of these CROs explained to the patients he secretly enrolled that this is not, never mentioned that this is a study, but said this is a charitable donation from Europe of a particular drug, and you are very lucky that you have access to it. So the people were not aware that they were included in a study, and some had serious adverse events and didn't know what happened. They thought they were given by charity an approved drug. So this is also a case of ethics dumping, because that would not be possible in Europe. Okay, the second one is researchers from high-income countries not being aware of how to conduct themselves to do research ethically. This is a study that was started in the US, where researchers said we really need to do something against a particular type of malnutrition in Uganda. And what we want to do is we want to develop a genetically modified vitamin-enriched banana. And all of the research would have been undertaken in the US, and then this would have been exported. The person who wrote this case study for me is from the University of Cape Town, and she explained to our entire group that this may sound like a good idea when a high-income country sees a deficit in a lower-income country where nothing seems to be happening, that they come with their research. But in this case, she said it's something called nutritionism. Rather than looking at what is required locally, working with local communities, and in the process finding out that there are local bananas that have a higher vitamin E content than the one they were going to develop, it's doing something high-tech in a high-tech country, not checking how this would be implemented, and then just looking at the molecular basis of a problem rather than the bigger problem, working with the community. So some people call this ethics dumping, but I would say that's a bit strong, but at least it's a waste of resources, in this case of US resources. Now the second of three videos I'd like to show you. This is somebody who explains, in that case, he explained to me, like the previous interviewee as well, what can go wrong if people come from abroad not knowing how they should behave.
As a man's it's crucial when you eyes by a good option. Your eyes moet the deer in, so that niemand by the venster can come. Moet die deer come by the leierskap. Ons vra nie geld nie, glad nie. Dat het nog nie by ons gebeur dat die leierskap geld vra vir navorsing nie.
And one more person.
So shall I say? Onze kennis is met baie plekke gevat, self gevat, self gedoen, deur slim mense. Mense wat kom ons mooi inlei met 'n 10 randjie en 'n 5 randjie. En dan kry hulle die kennis en dan werk hulle met hom. Die enigste oplossing, dink ek, volgens my domheid, as ons probeer om te verstaan wat hulle doen en hulle ons verstaan wat ons wil hê wat gedoen moet word. En ons saam kan werk, kan ons 'n baie beter en 'n goeie toekoms vir alle afstammeling volke belê.
So what these two colleagues of mine, the first one died shortly after the video, explain is that in their setting, community approval is essential for research. This is something that many people are now aware of, but without understanding why. So the second person illustrates this somewhat because he says people come from researchers from abroad, they give 5 rand, which is about 20 cent, and then they take photos, videos, lots of interviews, they go home with their data or their genetic sample, and then they are never seen again, and some even develop a commercial product from it. So this sort of unfairness can best be blocked by community approval, by seeing, is this research relevant to the community, for instance? And you will hear again about the sun later. So we've now had examples for two main reasons for ethics dumping. The third one is that high-income country researchers go purposefully into a country where they exploit loopholes. I think I've got two examples for this. This is social science research, which was undertaken in Liberia shortly after the first major Ebola crisis, where the researcher flew in, undertook interviews with people who were traumatized survivors without any ethics approval and without local collaboration. And then returning home, he discovered he will not be able to publish, it was a young researcher, the results without ethics approval. So he gave money to somebody locally to try and persuade the ethics committee from Liberia to give retrospective approval, but they didn't grant it. But this is a case of ethics dumping. You would never try to do that, for instance, in Germany, to talk to traumatized people without ethics approval as a researcher. So that's the first example. And the second one is about animal research, which is highly restrictive, some say, in Europe. And so this researcher, a neuroscientist working on brain diseases, took his research to Kenya, where wild-caught baboons can be used also for invasive research. And the hurdles you have to overcome are also much lower. But that's also a typical case of ethics dumping, where you move or offshore your research to a less restrictive regime. And this is the last one, a pharmaceutical company undertaking research where somebody in China, where somebody had a serious adverse event and was not compensated for it. This lady did go to court and after 7 years did obtain compensation, but this would also not happen in a high-income country. If you incur a problem as part of research, you will get compensated. Okay, now coming to the last one, where I won't give you an example. It's perfectly clear that countries that cannot even lift people out of extreme poverty will not have the funding to have well-resourced research ethics committees. But these are the four reasons why ethics dumping happens. So just wanted to ask you whether you know of any cases or have heard of any ethics dumping cases or something that you would describe as ethics dumping. You don't have to, Verena?
I worked 7 months in Congo, not mm-hmm. in Ebola, mm. but with bonobos. And I remember that's now 15 years ago, but we, in that, 15 years ago, mm. we had the discussion how to behave as intruders to this mm. different culture, right? But along the way, now listening to this talk, also, in the last 15 years, you hear more and more discussions about these things. We didn't just look into the bonobo groups that were free-ranging there, mm. but we also took plant samples, right, mm. to then analyze them in Germany and see whether there's mm. components that can be used. Mm. For example, bonobos in some certain yeah. plants against malaria. Mm. So that, I guess, would be one of those
yes.
cases.
Totally. If, whilst you think of whether you can think of another example, what Verena talked about is also a violation of the Convention on Biological Diversity, but obviously it wasn't 15 years ago, no, it was already, yes, it was already adopted. It says that you cannot take samples of microbial, animal, or plant origin out of the country without having mutually agreed terms. And
but
one of
that took, they also were they were analyzed not only in Germany but also in Kinshasa.
Mm. Oh, okay, no, that, then that's better.
But it still feels a bit.
Yeah, but the yeah. this is the Convention on Biodiversity is what started this whole discussion about fairness in research exchanges. That it's not just the researcher who has the knowledge and brings something to the undertaking, but also that people who donate samples, especially if they come from highly vulnerable populations, have to have some benefit. Yeah?
More generally, I mean, the concept of biopiracy, mm. The idea of pharmaceutical companies growing places and obtaining indigenous knowledge for about plants and then developing that into medicine, that's, would that qualify, fall under the idea of dumping?
In my view, yes, that's also what the colleagues from the Sun community talked about. But it doesn't just happen with pharmaceutical companies, can be PhD students. What we found in our research on ethics dumping, usually people blame the high profit pharmaceutical industry for this kind of behavior, but they are very, very heavily regulated and very aware of potential reputational loss. So it's more young researchers who don't really know what to do, who are perceived as exploitative locally. Yeah?
I think there are many cases of this outside of the so-called scientific endeavors of this type of dumping. But your first point about moving from one country to the other is, I think, a better way to understand that context. So if you come from another country to this place here in EMBL, it's not just you that will benefit when you go back, but the people that are here. And I think with these ethics dumping questions, as a community, you also want to understand what resources you have, how you can have a relationship with those resources, how you can learn and understand what they are. So for me, part of ethics dumping is not...
Part of ethics dumping for me is also that relationship that you were describing, to say you've got to transfer something in return. When you come to EMBL, you transfer something to local people in that environment in turn. I think with the San people, that's what they struggle with, is that they have these resources, they share their knowledge, but nobody returns that knowledge. They can build an accumulative perspective of what they have and how they can use that to benefit their society.
Yeah.
Whereas in countries like this, you will assume, of course, if you come to EMBL, you must contribute to the EMBL community.
Mm. No, that's exactly the exploitation aspect that they would point out. And the answer to this is to build equitable partnerships rather than take something out and then ask, so what could be the benefit, so that I can tick the benefit sharing box. And I'd like to show you now how a group that I led went about it. And this is part of the group. And we produced, I would call it a product, a global code that is now being used by the European Commission, was launched in the European Parliament, and is now mandatory for all EU funding. And I tell you a bit about it and how it protects people from ethics dumping. So this is an ethics code. You will all use ethics codes. And you might say, and you'd be right in some respect, that there already are 2,500 codes, ethics codes in the world. This is the Chicago-based collection of them. Do we really need another ethics code? Isn't that enough? And I'd like to explain to you now how this one is different and how it builds equitable partnerships. Firstly, it's different because it was created not by one institution in one country, but covering all continents by 55 authors, with the majority from low and middle income countries. And by chance, we had a majority of women leaders in the team. And these are some pictures taken, the top one at the UNESCO, but also engagement locally, South Africa, India, and South Africa again. We had vulnerable populations speaking for themselves, people from the Sun or former sex workers from Nairobi involved in all of the research from the start, because we believe it's not possible to make decisions on behalf of other people if you come from Germany and you're talking to a sex worker in Nairobi, for instance. It's only their view that counts on how they want to be protected from exploitation. The code. And I've got some that I could give out. It's very short. It's 23 articles. The ethics codes are normally very long, but this one isn't, because it's value-based and it doesn't tell you about every eventuality that you can encounter in a low and middle income setting, but instead it tells you how to reason through a problem and what are the main prescriptions. We are currently available in 8 languages. Is anybody here who can say what is the top one, for instance? What is that? Testing whether you're really as international as I was told. So the German one? Yeah. Anyhow, the languages are at the bottom. Arabic is coming, and Khoza, which is a local language in South Africa as well. The framework that we decided to use, fairness, respect, care, and honesty, is something we developed with these 55 authors. And from the beginning, internationally, we had major success with it, especially in Asia, where and in Africa, where people say respect is something that is not included in any of the Western moral frameworks, but we believe it's important. Community approval, for instance, is about respect. And this was 1 month after we launched the code. It was already taken up by Al Jazeera television, and for half an hour they displayed, when they discussed exploitation in research, our four values. So that showed that they resonate internationally, and they did so very quickly. Then that was 1 month after we had launched the code in the parliament in Europe, in Brussels. And we had Jeffrey Sachs, who is called the most famous economist on the planet, with us, and he endorsed it for us. He said the world is unfair. We're talking about research and development in an unfair world. And this code addresses this unfairness. Because very often research ethics guidelines can be 100 pages long, but they leave the elephant that is in the room out of the equation and do not talk about what it's like when high-income country researchers have to offer funds when they come to low and middle-income countries, what are the incentives, problems, etc. But Jeffrey Sachs, as you would imagine, knows about that. This is the Deputy Director General of DG Research and Innovation, who made it possible that the code, 1 month after its launch, became a mandatory reference document for Horizon 2020. And I was told informally this will continue into the next framework. He also was the first adopter of the code. And if you go to Horizon 2020 ethics rules, you will see that we are the only code other than the European Code of Conduct for Research Integrity that is under the legal documents, rules and codes of conduct. So this obviously was a major success, and the 2,500 ethics codes that already exist haven't had such fast implementation. Then 1 month later, we had a second adopter, the EDCTP, European and Developing Countries Clinical Trials Platform, which is a African-European cooperation to fund clinical trials for neglected diseases in Africa. Here, this is the director. He makes a statement that is very strong, but also should be very obvious. What is unethical in Europe is unethical in Africa. And that's what is the spirit of the code. The third adopter was a few months ago, the University of Cape Town. And I forgot to put in the fourth adopter, which was my university. So we now have four, and 10 others in Europe and in Africa are currently in the process of adopting the code for all of their staff. So for instance, University of Cape Town is a major, the biggest and most successful university in Africa, and all of their researchers now have to abide by the code. We had major media interest, and I think it's partly because people like the word ethics dumping. We were in Nature, Guardian, Economist, Times Higher Education, and with some of them on several occasions. We had an invitation to the Vatican, where we presented the code. And now coming back to the four reasons for ethics dumping, asking what can a code really do? What can it do for communities that are unable to stand up for their rights? I'll say a bit more about this in a moment. What can they do for researchers who are unaware? This is something the European Commission also uses it for training purposes. Even though it's very short, I think reading it serves for educational purposes, because some of the things you will think, oh, one should definitely do that, but some of the things might not be something you have thought about before. When researchers commit ethics dumping deliberately, it's very difficult to do something with an ethics code. But it's also very difficult to do something with other laws or with compliance mechanisms. The case that I've already talked to Sandra about after lunch was a Chinese scientist who in Beijing did the CRISPR-Cas experiment with two baby girls. An economist journalist from Beijing talked to me over the phone and afterwards decided to call this ethics dumping, not because it was a Chinese scientist in China, obviously, but because the American PhD supervisor was heavily involved. And the American PhD supervisor lost his job and the next job he was meant to take on in Singapore as a result of this case. So if more such cases happen where there are immediately very detrimental consequences from ethics dumping, not just reputational loss, things might change. But that's currently the biggest case. And under-resourced research ethics committees are helped if they have something concrete that they can say, for instance, to European-based researchers who have Horizon 2020 funding, well, you are meant to do so and so and so, but you're not doing it. And this doesn't require them to read books or a 90-page ethics document. But what can communities unable to defend themselves do with such a code? Alongside this global code, which addresses mostly people in Europe, we worked on the Sun Code of Research Ethics to protect the Sun community in the Kalahari from exploitation. So they have used the same values but have written their own code. And there again, we had major media success, as you can see. That's only some of them, National Geographic, Scientists, Science, Nature, etc. And what is unique about this code, it's also very short, but what I personally find very, very powerful is that they say, for instance, under respect, they say what they want to happen, and then they say, we have encountered lack of respect in many instances in the past within this code. In genomics research, our leaders were avoided and respect was not shown to them. Researchers took photographs of individuals in their homes of breastfeeding mothers of underage children whilst ignoring our social customs and norms. Bribes and other advantages were offered. So they say, we expect from researchers so-and-so, and then at the end of it, they explain how they have suffered in the past. And this makes this code, in my view, a very powerful, also educational tool. And what my group is currently trying to do is to help other communities build their own codes, because the Sun community feels mostly exploited for their traditional knowledge, but the sex workers in Nairobi, with whom we're working now, don't have traditional knowledge. They feel potentially exploited from the research on various sexually transmitted diseases. But this is one way where this big code can make a difference in ensuring that these local codes are also promoted. And I was definitely too fast because I wanted to talk for 45 minutes and then bring the code in order to discuss the individual articles. But I want to end with this section of the paper with a rap that's about 4 minutes long, and it's young Sun people who would like to show that they want the values of fairness, respect, care, and honesty respected whenever researchers come into their community.
Sun, God, the sun.
This video was produced with almost no money, and it won a competition. The project, the EU-funded project I led, had started in order to ensure that the people who are affected by exploitation are the ones who say what they don't like. So, what I thought is, you now have an overview of the code and of what ethics dumping is. Obviously, we'll have a discussion. You might have questions. But what I also brought is a file that gives the 23 articles. They're all very short. So in the remaining time after the discussion, what we could also do is look at the code and see how this, where this is relevant, especially in your specialist expertise. I'm assuming, of course, we have the hour and a half, and we don't want to release people into the sun earlier. But that's why I brought two files. So questions first, and then the other file.